Good morning, everyone. It's a pleasure to be in Vizag, and I'd like to thank Krishna IVF Clinic, Dr. Sridevi, Dr. Ramaraju, and the team for giving me this invitation and the opportunity to be here. The task before me is to talk about prevention and prediction of preterm labor. Where do we stand today? And as obstetricians, we all know that preterm labor is a big dilemma which we face, and very often we don't know what to do. I had a patient who had come about, you know, a year ago. Her first pregnancy, she had had cramping pain, contractions, and bleeding. And at about 22, 23 weeks, she had gone in, and she then lost that pregnancy. She was told that she had preterm labor, and in the next pregnancy, they told her, we'll put you on medication, we'll give you progesterone, and we'll give you medications to calm the uterus. So she had tocolysis, she had progesterone, she had a measurement of cervical length, which was normal. And yet, at 24 weeks, she started cramping, contracting, and lost that pregnancy. She moved obstetricians and then was told, well, we'll do all of that and we'll also take a stitch, and then we'll see, you know, we should be able to salvage the pregnancy. At 24 weeks, she started cramping on the stitch. The stitch was cut, and she then lost the pregnancy. And so it can be a very, very difficult problem for obstetricians to handle, and it can be a very, very distressing problem for the couple when they have recurrent preterm labor, and sometimes we don't necessarily have all the answers. In a larger sense, people are worried about preterm labor because of the implications of cost, and in the United States, they say that nearly $6 billion are spent annually on preterm babies. Some preterm labors are spontaneous, some are iatrogenic, and some follow PPROM. And we all know that with the improvement in neonatal care, we are not so worried about babies that are born after 34, 35 weeks, but we are worried about babies that are born less than 32 weeks, and that's about 1 to 2% of births, but associated with 60% of mortality and 50% of neurological sequelae. And we are quite aware of all the morbidity that can be associated with preterm labor. And as neonatal advances happen, and as hopefully we get better at prediction and prevention, even if we push the gestational age of delivery by a week or 2 weeks, we may be able to achieve better neonatal outcomes. And though this data is from 2002, you can see that there is a distinct advantage in survival that happens after about 29 to 30 weeks. So if we can achieve that, even that much of prolongation, we will make a difference. So what are the goals of early detection of preterm labor? Essentially to transfer a woman with, with a possibility of preterm labor to a facility where she can have good neonatal care and give us time to give glucocorticoids. So therefore, it is important that if we can predict preterm labor primarily before it starts, we will be on a better wicket and we'll be better able to help these women. So prediction of preterm labor then is a logical goal, provided we can meet the criteria required of any screening program. That is, that there should be a screening protocol that is efficient. It should have a high sensitivity, a high negative predictable value, and should be available at a low cost. Secondly, screening is worthwhile if we have an effective intervention or treatment for individuals for whom a positive test is available. And we can see as we go along where preterm labor stands in this kind of scenario. So how do we traditionally diagnose preterm labor? Once we have persistent contractions accompanied by cervical dilatation and effacement, and the most accurate means of predicting preterm labor traditionally within 1 to 7 days used to be contraction frequency, beginning of cervical dilatation or effacement, rupture of membranes or vaginal bleeding. But you will all agree that that's too late, because by then the damage is done and we have very little to actually prevent that labor from progressing. And in the last few years, we've had a lot of data and a lot of research that has gone into other markers for predicting preterm labor, such as ultrasound measurement of cervical length, which Sridevi so eloquently spoke about, and by other biochemical markers. The only point that one of the first points that I want to stress is that when we're looking at methods of prediction, we have to understand what is it that we're using the test for. Are we using it to predict which woman is going to get into preterm labor, or are we using a test to detect whether that woman has got into preterm labor or not? And the performance of the test will vary depending upon the population and the reason for which we are applying. So if we look at cervical length, for example, you can look at cervical length and say, is this woman likely to go into preterm labor? That's one set of reasons, one set of studies that have looked at that. And then you can take symptomatic women in whom you are uncertain whether she's in preterm labor or not, and use cervical length to help us detect or confirm if she's in preterm labor or not. And the performance of the test will vary. Now, the most important method of predicting is actually with assessment of risk. And risk assessment goes by getting a detailed history and some of the factors which actually increase the relative risk of a woman getting into preterm labor are a BMI less than 20, a heavy work, and cigarette smoking, even though that may not yet be a significant issue in our country. So if you look at the past reproductive history, you'll find that the highest risk comes from a woman who has had two previous preterm deliveries, or a woman who has had a second trimester loss. So the history becomes important, and we have now risk development, risk prediction scores, such as the Cleopatra score, which look at the previous preterm delivery and cervical length, and another score which can also look at fetal fibronectin, which helps us predict the risk of the woman developing a preterm labor and the subsequent pregnancy. And again, here you see that the presence of a previous preterm labor is far more important than any other characteristic, whether it is cervical length or not. But if you look at the Cochrane data, they say that the scoring systems are yet to be completely validated. Monitoring uterine activity is one of the early means of testing which was looked at. The advantage is it can be applied to the whole population, but it has a very poor sensitivity, and further studies are needed before we can do home uterine monitoring as a method of prediction of preterm labor. Moving on to infection, we all know that there is an inflammatory and infective pathology which actually sets the stage or forms the basis of both PPROM and preterm labor. And screening for asymptomatic bacteria will reduce the risk of preterm labor. There are some small studies which actually say that screening for periodontal infection may also find a subgroup of women which will, and treating that periodontal infection may minimize the risk of preterm labor. But the role of routine screening for cervical vaginal infection is less clear, and there is no definite cause-effect relationship between bacterial vaginosis and preterm labor. So we don't have to screen all our women for infection with an attempt to prevent preterm labor. But we know that if we took a subgroup of women in whom a previous preterm delivery has happened and then screen them and treat them for bacterial vaginosis, they do improve. And the 2009 Cochrane review says that there is evidence that infection screening before treatment programs in pregnant women before 20 weeks of gestation reduces the risk of preterm birth and preterm low birth weight. But future trials are needed to evaluate what type of infection program should be done for this kind of screening. So